proud of it. One of who this group is up here. My name is Michael Palamaki. I am the choir director at Concordia Lutheran High School, just down the road here in Tomball. The group in front of you that I'll be singing for you a little bit this afternoon is the chamber choir from our school. They are an auditioned ensemble that is selected from our larger 75 voice concert choir. And we meet twice a week in the morning at 7:15 to rehearse and prepare for our concerts and contests throughout the year, which we just got done with our Christmas concerts last night, and so the students have been working hard towards that. This is our last day before finals start, and so we're excited to be here to share the Christmas spirit and some songs with you this afternoon. Some of the pieces will be Christmas-themed, others will be stuff we performed at the fall concert. So I hope you enjoy. We're going to start out with a piece entitled I Will Greatly Rejoice, and I believe it is based from the text Isaiah chapter 61, verses 10 through 11. So here we go.
I will greatly rejoice in the Lord, for my soul shall exalt in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bride as of bridegroom decks himself with a garment, and as a bride adorns herself with the jewels, herself with the jewels.
Ooh.
out here to perform for you. This is probably our fifth, sixth year in a row for doing this. And really appreciate the opportunity to come and just give you some entertainment and to share the Christmas message with you all this afternoon while you guys enjoy your dinner. Did Mr. Are you going to say something?
When you're done, after you're done with your last song.
Okay, cool. Our last piece we're going to perform for you is one we actually did at our Christmas concert last night with this group. And it's John Rutter's arrangement of I Wonder As I Wander. And the soloist in this will be Catherine Bolt. So this is I Wonder As I Wander.
Sing their praises a little bit. You might not know me, even though each of the 5 or 6 years that you have graciously invited us to come out, I think most of those years I've either been here in attendance and or been the bus driver. Today I didn't have to drive the bus, but I'm Matt Schleicher. I'm blessed to be assistant principal at Concordia Lutheran High School. I've been blessed to be there 11 years, and therefore I've seen how Concordia is a part of the greater Tomball community and how the community as a whole has embraced us as a school, as evidenced by the repeat invitation to come back, right? So for that, we thank you. But at the same time, I'm just going to sing the praises of this group, and they are representatives of those groups that have come before. So here we go. You don't have to write this all down. I'm not in really teacher mode, but here it comes. This group is representative of those groups that have come before, like the last 7 years. So let's just deal with 7 years. If I'm not mistaken, and Mr. Palamaki will correct me if I'm wrong, I think it's 6 out of the last 7. Am I right? Before you know where I finish?
I think it's
7 out of the last 8.
I want to be that guy. But
let's be conservative, because I might have my stats wrong. Here's the conservative stat. 6 out of the last 7 years we've been state champs in TAPS with our choir. Now, not being conservative, it might be 7 out of the last 8. That's right, because the 1 year that we didn't, which I think was the year 2012, we were state runner-up. That's second place for those of you who are taking notes. So with that, this is just a very storied program that we have that is the vocal music at Concordia. But at the same time, last year, for the first time in our history, we were also state champs in our band. And so our fine arts are very, very strong at Concordia. Let's just thank these guys for being here again. Okay. And to boot, you might get to know them a little bit, even though we are going to have to scoot out a little bit after dinner, after lunch. Sorry, because finals come tomorrow. So we're not going to be able to kind of rub shoulders too much with y'all, but nevertheless, these students also contribute in many other ways to Concordia. We have football players, we have cheerleaders, we have those that are involved in speech, debate, competitive one-act play, the musical, you name it. This is a great cross-section of the talents the Lord has blessed us with at Concordia. And you know what? I'm going to lead the charge for one more round of applause.
I want to say a few things about the speaker. The speaker named Mike Roth. Mike is currently the director of donor development for 89.3 KSBJ. Anybody listen to this?
Yes.
I didn't think about it, but it's the largest Christian radio station in the United States. Is that right, Mike?
That is right.
Okay, a little about Mike. Mike is in donor development since 2001. He began his work with the YMCA of Detroit in 2001.
Wow.
To help them open their first new YMCA in that area in more than 50 years. Rick said, wow, Rick's working for Detroit for 2 years. My daughter also lived there. It's quite a jam in the rich. Prior to joining KSBJ in June of this year, Mike was with the International, or before this year, he was with the International Cooperating Ministries, where he served as a National Director of Development for 7 years. During that time, Mike traveled all over the world with ICM, helping to equip and encourage Christians to grow disciples and build their church. A lot of that was foreign work, too, wasn't mine. Mike attended Eastern Kentucky University in Richmond as a student athlete. His team won their conference in all 4 years that Mike was there, and two Final Four appearances before graduating with a degree in police administration in 1992. Mike was a Jewish believer. He is a Jewish believer. Mike has shared his powerful testimony all over the world and is passionate about what God has allowed him to be a part of right here in Houston. Mike has been married to Monica for 24 years. They have two wonderful children. You'll probably say something about they announced to him, you should tell me last week, that both of them announced that they were going to get married. The son is... is Kyle, who is serving in the Air Force, and Courtney, who will graduate from the University of North Texas in December. But within the same week, they both told Mike that they would be, they found someone they love and they'll be getting married. So that's two marriages. I told Mike he didn't escape it. Having two boys, he's got to pay for one of them. So anyway, if you ever have a chance to, I met mine at a luncheon. Bo, my son, and Ann, my son and daughter-in-law, were at a restaurant, and I had a chance to ask me to come along. And, I met Mike, and Mike is like a breath of fresh air. What I can say about Mike is he's very humble, and he is the kind of guy that you see the Lord reflecting all of him in his speech and all of his mannerisms. At this time, I'm going to turn it over to Mike. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Good luck, man. Hey, good luck. He says good luck. Hey, everybody.
Hey.
So I'm not a professional speaker. I'm just a guy who, just like you guys, I love the Lord. It's been very, very good to me. And, I struggled for a while getting up and talking about myself, but what I realized was this is not about me at all. It's about Jesus Christ. And so I'm going to share you his story that he has lived out through me. So I'll share a little about that. But first, I got to tell you a quick story about Bo Adams. Raise your hand. Okay. So Bo told me this story, and it was pretty cool. It was about when he was being recruited to play college football. Any Aggies in the house? We got any Aggies or Aggie fans? Come on. Okay. Well, we got a couple Aggie football players here. And Bo played linebacker for the Aggies. And when he was being recruited, you go through this recruiting process. I went through it at Eastern Kentucky, but nowhere near at the level that Bo was going through. So he was down to his three choices of schools. He was down to Texas Tech. He was down to, UT, and it was down to Texas A&M, trying to decide where he wanted to go. And so he went on his visit to, first I think it was Texas Tech, and the head coach was Mike Leach. And he goes in, they go through the whole process, they're really recruiting him hard, and then they go into the head coach's office, and he's sitting down looking around at all the stuff that Texas Tech has, and great tradition at Texas Tech, and Mike Leach is getting ready to talk to him about to offer him a scholarship. And he looks at his desk, and on the desk over here, he sees this red phone, this bright red rotary style phone. These guys over here have never seen a phone like that in their life. And he said, "Coach, what's up with that phone?" And Coach Leach said, "Well, that's a direct line to God. It's a direct line to God." And so Bo was like, "Tell me more about this. What's going on?" He said, "For $75 a minute, I've got a direct line to God." And Bo was blown away. So anyway, he goes the next week. He's being recruited by UT, and he goes, and Mac Brown, same thing. He goes into the, has the whole experience, and then it's time to go into the coach's office. And he's about to be offered a scholarship, and he's looking around at just everything in Mac Brown's office. It's just unbelievable. We have UT folks here? Any UT folks here? Yeah. Okay. We got to give a little bit of love, right? So I'm a Florida Gator fan myself, so there we go. Chomp, chomp. So he's in Mac Brown's office, and he's looking around, and he sees the same red phone on Mac Brown's desk. And he can't believe what he's seeing. He's kind of eyeballing it. And Mac sees him, and he's like, "Bo, do you know about that? You know about that phone?" He said, "I do." He goes, "Tell me what you know about that phone." He said, "That's a direct line to God. For $75 a minute, you've got a direct line to God." He goes, "You got it. You got it." And so he can't believe what he's seeing. So then next week, he goes to Texas A&M. Who was the coach? Was it Mike Sherman? Slocum. Goes into Jerry Slocum's office, same thing, just tradition, right, in this office, and he's looking around, checking it all out, and what's the first thing he looks for, though? The red phone. And sure enough, was the red phone on the desk? It was right there on the desk, right? And he can't believe his eyes, and so he's looking at this thing, and Jerry Slocum says, "You know about that phone?" He goes, "I know all about that phone." He goes, "Tell me what you know about that phone." He said, "Coach, that's a direct line to God. For $75 a minute, you have a direct line to God." He goes, "Well, you're partially right." He said, "Here in College Station, it's a toll-free call." Right? Isn't that what he told you? So... it's a little difficult to come up and speak after that performance. Those guys were unbelievable. That is extremely humbling. You guys are awesome. Thank you so much. That was a blessing. And as Jim shared with you, I do serve at KSBJ. I've been there since June. I started with KSBJ, and I came kicking and screaming. Believe it or not, KSBJ is awesome, and I love every minute of what I do. But I was working for International Cooperating Ministries, and we were building the church all over the world. We were growing disciples. I got to travel to, I was to Vietnam twice. I was in Russia, Africa. I was all over Latin America. I was all over the world. It was so cool, all in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, if you would have asked me 8 years ago, would we ever do missionary work? You're talking to the wrong guy. I love Jesus, and he's been good to me, but that's not me. That's not me. And it's funny when you tell God what you're going to do, tell God your plans, right? Isn't that funny? Anybody tell God their plans before? Yeah, he laughed at you. He laughed at me. So, as Jim said, I am the son of a New York City police officer. I was 10 when we moved out of New York. I do come from a Jewish family, and I am the very first believer in the entire history of my family. Can someone do me a favor so I can be respectful of everybody's time? Someone give me a little like this. I meant to bring my phone up and try and be professional. I told you I wasn't a professional speaker. So growing up in my father's house was not easy. as was mentioned, he was a police officer in New York City through the 60s and 70s. And in New York at the time, it was like a war zone there. And my father went to work in that war zone every day. And it does a job on you. We know a lot of the psychological effects today than they didn't really know about what was going on then. It was what it was. But couple that with the fact that my father failed as an athlete, and he didn't know God. And he was a Jew from an Orthodox Jewish family, but there's no relationship with God. Just so we can get that out there. I know people have a lot of questions about Jews, God's chosen people and all that, and it's got nothing to do with the people. It's all about God and his plan, not about them. So my father became a very, very angry man because of everything that he dealt with. He had three sons, and the three of us, I'm the middle child. So anybody want to psychoanalyze me, you can do that later. But I'm the middle of three sons, and my father was a great, great athlete. He was the son, his father, who was my grandfather, his name, by the way, this is how Jewish we are, his name is Moses. My grandfather's name was Moses. He was a great track star. My grandfather set the New York City high jump record when he was young. My father played basketball for Bridgeport University and was also a track star, triple jump, running broad jump, all that. He could stand, he was my height, he could stand underneath a basketball goal, jump straight up, and get both elbows over the rim. Unbelievable athlete. I did not get that athletic ability. But he was anti-Semitism was running rampant for the youngins in the house. I'll just say, anti-Semitism towards a Jew is just hate. How would you guys say it? It's just hate towards the Jewish race, anti-Semitism, and we dealt with a lot of it. I dealt with it growing up as well. I got into fights all the time because of it growing up. But my father dealt with it from his college basketball coach. And it was really, really rough. And this kind of laid out a series of events because of it. And what happened, they were playing a basketball team, and my grandparents never went to my father's athletic events, okay? And that might sound weird to some folks who were at all over your kids' events, but that's the way it was back then. And this one time they were playing a game, and my grandparents drove all the way to Connecticut from Brooklyn, New York, to see my father play, and they were blowing this team out. And the coach on purpose, the coach was anti-Semite, wouldn't put my father in the game on purpose. Knew that my grandparents were there. And so after the game, my father goes up to the coach with his uniform, throws it in the coach's face and says, "Are you happy now?" And the coach says, "No, I'm not," and starts taking off his jacket. He's going to fight my father. As he pulls his jacket over his arms, popped him right in the nose, and it was an ugly scene, and he ruined his entire college career. Got blackballed, couldn't play basketball anymore, couldn't do track. All of that because he had a bad temper and didn't know how to control himself. And so therefore, fast forward, he becomes a cop, he has kids, and he has all boys, and he is not going to let those boys make the same mistakes that he made. And surely he is not going to let his boys get pushed around. If anybody says about you anything about you being a Jew, you take them down. That's the way I grew up. My brother got into a fight, and one of the kids that he was fighting got a good shot on him. And he got, after the fight was over, he came in the house, and he got it worse when he got in the house from my father. I grew up, if I got a bad grade or playing catch with my father, you know, a lot of people, it's a great privilege and it's a special thing to do things with your father, go fishing with your father, play catch with your father, do all these things with your father, right? For me, it was a scary, scary time, because if I didn't hit my father in the chest with the baseball every time, he would fire that thing at me as hard as he could. If I got a bad grade in school, I got punched in the face. If I showed I remember I was playing basketball in middle school and I made a bad pass. And after just screaming at me as we were driving home, he said to me, "I despise the way you play basketball. What do you think I heard? I despise you." This is the way I grew up, and my brothers grew up the same way. I'm sorry to the young lady who's working the camera. I'm all over the You're so good. You're so good. But this is me. I'm sorry. If I park myself here, I'm just... What would you like me to do? Would you like me there? Okay, she's a pro. So I'm going to move along and just tell you guys, kind of get the point. But what he did is he created in me somebody that was, I became like a monster. I hated everybody. I can go on and on and tell you, as I was growing up, I was a really good athlete. I was very good at baseball. I was very good at basketball. I was very good at wrestling. Football was actually the sport that I went the furthest on. It was my least favorite. But it was just kind of the way things played out. But I started dating my girlfriend, who has eventually become my wife of almost 25 years. This coming year will be 25 years that my wife and I have been married. And we started dating when I was 16. And so this issue was like the beauty that was calming the savage beast, because I was a mess. And it was (clears throat) Excuse me, I have these little moments sometimes. We were at one of my football games. And again, keep in mind what I'm going through, all this inner rage that's going. And then my wife, my girlfriend at the time, came to my football game. It was an away game. She got a migraine headache, and she left the game at halftime and was attacked at in the parking lot. And so this was another thing that just took me to a whole other level of hate and aggression. And if I didn't have sports, I would have killed somebody. There's no doubt about it. And having to deal with all that, dealing with my father, dealing with a bone tumor developed in my shoulder. We were having conversations about, you know, our sports careers. My older brother was an All-American at the University of Florida. And I'm trying to live up to what he's doing. And I've got a bone tumor in my shoulder, and I don't know that it's a bone tumor. I just know I can't use it, and I know I've got all these eyes on me that is eventually could lead to a scholarship, and I have all these expectations, so I got to keep my mouth shut. And this tumor is actually got so big, it fractured my shoulder. And it had all these tentacles, and it would fracture, start to heal up, and then refracture again. But I just kept playing. I didn't tell anybody. And I put so much pressure on myself. Can you imagine doing that without Jesus Christ in your life? That's where I was. And so fast forward, my wife and I get married, and we have two beautiful kids that we've heard a little about, but my son was developmentally delayed, and they thought he had autism. And so I'm dealing with that. I was like, when I found out I was having a boy, I was like, it's on. Oh man, this kid's gonna be something. But God had other plans. In fact, I'm gonna tell you about what God's plan were. My son didn't even start on his high school football team. Now, when you have the family genes in sports, like my family. Okay, I told you about my father, my grandfather. I did well. My older brother was in the league for a little while in the NFL. My younger brother played football on scholarship. My nephew, who's the same age as my son, played for Virginia Tech. My son didn't even break into the starting lineup in his high school. Don't you think he knew about all his family? Yeah. So we had so many great conversations about God and God's plan. So I'm just going to brag on my son for a second. He received this. I think I read this to Bo a few months ago, but my son has officially become a staff sergeant in the Air Force, and he does intelligence work, okay? And this was his second Air Force Achievement Medal. Okay, he's the one who was diagnosed. They thought he had autism. And Senior Airman Kyle J. Roth distinguished himself by outstanding achievement as mission manager. So he's managing other intelligence agents, okay? For the 3rd Intelligence Squadron, 480th Intelligence Surveillance and Reconnaissance Group, Fort Gordon, Georgia, on May 9th this year, Airman Roth supervised real-time intelligence support to a short-notice mission to neutralize a high-value terrorist operations facilitator. Poised under pressure, he oversaw production of dozens of time-sensitive reports, enabling the NSA to appraise tactical commanders of enemy movements throughout the direct action raid. Airman Ross' management of his team postured a 30-member multinational assault force to successfully neutralize the objective, as well as a regional militia commander, while guaranteeing no friendly casualties. Additionally, he enabled friendly forces to liberate an important foreign dignitary held hostage by the target. Airman Roth's crucial intelligence to combat operations was lauded at every echelon of leadership. The distinctive accomplishments of Airman Roth reflect credit upon himself and the United States Air Force. Isn't that cool? That's cool. I'm so proud of that kid, And I remember when he was in my office at the house, and he's looking up, he's looking at my I Love Me wall, you know, with the plaques and everything. And he's sitting there, and he had just told me that he wasn't going to be starting on his team. And he does this, he looks up at the wall, puts, and goes like this. And I go, you know what, I've got an idea. He's like, what? What's that? I said, let's take all that stuff down. Let's take it out back and burn it all. He's like, what? Let's burn it all. He said, we're not doing that. Let's take my ring. I have some rings from championships. Let's burn it. He said, we're not doing that. Why would you say that? I said, because that's what it means. It means nothing. This is nothing. I haven't put pads on in 25 years. Right? When's the last time you put pads on? We define ourselves by these ridiculous things. He's defining himself by that. And, you know, I said, okay, your cousin, Matthew, at Virginia Tech, you want to switch places with him? Fine, we'll switch with him. Okay, but the caveat is, Matthew doesn't know Jesus. You want to switch? No. So I jumped around a little bit. I got excited. I told you I wasn't a professional. So Monica and I got married, and we had these beautiful kids, and our marriage began to fall apart. It wasn't based on relationship with God, and we got into financial trouble. I was working tons and tons of hours at a job that I hated, and oh, by the way, I became my father. The person that I really despised, I became him. And now I never laid a hand on my kids or my wife, but I could blow a gasket like that. And I often did. And it was scary for them. And I hated myself. I hated who I was. I hope nobody in here had this issue, but did you ever have a situation where you thought that you were supposed to be somebody? You knew, I'm supposed to be something, and I'm not. Anyone? I hope not. But that was me. I knew, sin was prevalent in my life, and I was a mess. And so after football was over, it was one of these things where I'm like, okay, so now my life is I work 65 hours a week, at a job that I hate, I come home, I argue with my wife, and I go to bed so that I can get up and go do this. And I was working 6-7 days a week, never got holidays off. It was in retail. And for me, that in that business, it was a mess. And so then my wife says to me, I'm not sure if I love you anymore. Our marriage was just beginning to implode. And so for me, I'm a hard worker. So I thought, I'll work my way out of this. I'll figure it out. I'll make more money. That was the answer. So working 65 hours a week, I decided to do a multi-level marketing deal that was going to bring it, and I was making money with it. And I was miserable. I was on the verge of suicide. I hated my life. I hated who I'd become. And I would dream up ways to kill myself and try and get the courage to do it, but I couldn't. And the thing that got, and I believe this was God that was protecting me, because he was giving me visions of my kids getting older without me. And it scared me to death what I saw, that this devastation was going to do to them. So I obviously I didn't do it. But I was at a meeting, and this guy, he was probably in his 60s. I was 30 at the time. And he knew of me, I knew of him, and he comes up to me. He says, Mike, what's wrong? I said, nothing's wrong. He said, why are you angry? I said, I'm not angry. He said, you should see your face. I just had this look on my face, like I wanted to push everybody away. I hated everybody. I just wanted to push everybody. I didn't even realize this, the look on my face. And so he sits me down. And he says, talk to, and he gets me to talk. I wouldn't talk to anybody. I would never tell anybody my problems. I would never show a chink in my armor. And he gets me to just vomit everything up to him. And I didn't share near any as much with you guys as, and it's not important because you can fill in the gaps. If you think about what it could have been, you were probably right. So he gets me just chucking it all to him. And he says, Mike, do you know Jesus Christ? And I'm a Jew. And you don't have the conversation. You just don't. You don't. Any time before that, if anybody would ever have a conversation with me and they start talking about Jesus, I would go just like, stop. I was a jerk. No, this is a Jesus story. You have to know. I'm glad you didn't know me then. But I'm just saying, if you knew me then and knew the joy and the love that I have in my life now, you would recognize. I mean, we're talking miracle, serious deal. And so I go, stop. If that's what you believe, that's fine, but don't push that on me. And the conversation was over. I'm a little larger than a lot of human beings, and right? We can intimidate somebody if we need to. And so I love doing that. So he asked me if I know Jesus. And this is what goes through my head. The words that come out of my mouth were, I don't know Jesus, but I want to hear about him. I was desperate. It was like, one way I've described it is if you have this button, this like reset button on your life, and you can't wait to just hit that button and get a fresh start. That's what I wanted so bad, but there was no, how do you get a fresh start? I've got all this disgusting baggage following me. And he tells me all about Jesus. And I can't believe my ears. I was getting excited. And then it was like the devil came from over here and he's like, no, you're a bad dude. Right? So I was like, and I said, I appreciate what you're saying, but I'm a bad guy. This is not for me. And he got stern with me. He's like, no, you're wrong. You're exactly who Jesus came for. And I I couldn't believe my ears. It was overwhelming to hear about this opportunity to have a fresh start, and that I don't have to. I have big shoulders, right? And I pride myself on being a man, right? Put it on my shoulder. I'll carry it. But the great lesson that I learned is I don't have to. He did it all. And I can't believe my ears. So I go home. And my wife was Catholic, by the way. And so when we got married in front of a priest and a rabbi at the same time. We made everybody happy. And so So I come home and I start telling it. Now, we've been together for a long time now, and she knows my family. And so I tell her about this conversation that I had about Jesus, and her jaw was in her lap. She can't believe what I'm telling her because she knows what's about to happen. There are consequences. And so for time's sake, I'll move it forward. You've heard about my father. My mother grew up in an Orthodox Jewish home as well. When I told them the great news, they disowned me. So it was the worst thing that I could have possibly done. And I'm trying to be a good person. I hate myself, and I know this is the right way to go. I know. And my family says, we're done with you. You've hurt us for the last time. This is what my family said to me. So I didn't know much scripture, but I dove into the Bible, and I came across scripture in Matthew where it talks about, if you love your mother and father more than me, you're not worthy of me. I just held on to that. And it's funny because I talk about how much I despise my father, but he was my father. And he rejected me again. So I was, you know, it's one step forward and three steps back as a brand new believer. And so I get a call a few months later, you know, the old, they're both on the phone, you know, on the different lines. Did you pick up? Pick up the phone! You know, they're both on the line. All right, we're both here. Yeah. So I'm on the phone, and they said, "You're our son, and we love you. Listen, though, no matter what you've done." You like that? So I had this giant target on my back, right? They've brought me back into their life. I've got this target. They've got their whole Jewish community and this and that. And again, to for the purposes of time, I will tell you that these same people that disowned me for becoming a believer of Jesus Christ, 12 years later, both prayed to receive Christ and were baptized. Those same people. It's Jesus. I mean, listen, these are New York Jews in their 70s. Right? Is that a miracle? Okay. If you knew my family, you'd know that it was a miracle. So I was this broken Jewish kid from New York, and God's plan was to take me and bring me into the mission world to build his church. Are you kidding me? But every day I try, it's a daily surrender. You know, when people say I surrendered my life to Christ, you know, in 1970, whatever, I have to do it daily. That's what works for, and I fail often. I can tell you that I'm just trying to follow, I'm trying to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. He has been so good to me. He replaced all that disgusting hate and rage that I dealt with. You guys just got a little fraction of what I had to deal with daily. He replaced that with peace. I mean, I'm so calm and relaxed. And I love, do I love you guys? We have so much fun. And the great thing is because of Jesus, not because of Mike Roth. Mike Roth is a mess. Jesus Christ is unbelievably faithful, and he allows me to do what I do. So I got to do this thing with ICM for 7 years. It was unbelievable. And they come, KSBJ comes calling, saying, "We're purchasing a new signal. We have had so many amazing people that have supported the ministry for years, and we don't know them. And we hear, they heard what I did. And we hear that this is something you might be able to help us with." And I said, "I'm glad to help design something, but I'm not interested in any job. I love what I do." And so they asked me like three times. Finally, you know, I told them, I said, you know, "I'm the national director of this. I get to do all these things." And they changed the whole job description for me. And then I started praying. I was like, "Lord, if this is what you want me to do, I need you to do it, because I'm not even going to try." So much so, you're going to love this, so much so, I was in my job interview that, you know, the round table discussion, they're all peppering me with questions, right? One of the people at KSBJ asked me, "Why do you want to work for KSBJ?" I said, "I don't." Try that on a job interview sometime. It was so freeing when you just give it to God. "God, if you want this, if I mess it up, you'll fix it." And he did. They offered me the job an hour later. It was unbelievable. So, but what I realized what God was doing is he's doing a great work here in Houston. He's doing a great work through KSBJ. And I didn't know. I knew about the music and that, but their mentoring program that they have, where they mentor Christian radio stations around the world and teach them how to reach their communities for Jesus Christ through the gospel on the air. They teach them how to do that. And so we just, KSBJ has been praying for years about millennials. And all of our churches have been praying for this this group of people who, as I've been praying through, Lord, what do you want me to do here? One of the things he gave me is that he shared with me that, you know, people, churches are going to the ends of the earth to reach the lost, to reach the unreached. And what God kind of made me know was that we have an unreached generation right here, and they need our help desperately. Desperately. It's a different time. We can say, well, they're kids. They'll come back. It's a different time. There's a desperation. We have some statistics. We have the NGen Hope Line. 91.7 is the new station that we're able to acquire, and we're in the middle of a capital campaign, $13.4 million campaign to get this paid for so that we can get deeper into the ministry work, and we're about halfway through that campaign. But this, the Hope Line for NGen, from October of 2013 through September, the end of September of this year, had 412 calls from young people to this Hope Line. Okay, we actually got the last call report from August 8th when we launched NGen of this year to the end of September. 102 of those 400 calls came in that 2 month period. Our kids are hurting. The reason, on the pie chart that they show, 65% of the calls that came in from those kids were about depression and suicidal thoughts. KSBJ also has a similar Hope Line. The majority of the calls that come in from for prayer at KSBJ are about financial issues. Our kids are hurting. And I have some, Jim, can we maybe hand this out to folks? I have some information for you guys, and I'd like you, let me just say this about, as a development officer, it's difficult sometimes because people have said, oh, you got to ask people for money. No, I get to share opportunities to impact lives. That's what I get to do. So I'm sharing this with you right now. We have an opportunity to impact lives. In that folder, you'll see there's a one pager on the right that really breaks that pie chart that I was sharing with you guys. You'll see that pie chart right there. And this is a bunch of the information that I was talking about. We have about $6 million, give or take, left on a $13.4 million campaign. And we're not leaving here until we raise it. Come on, people. Come on. I see you're considering it. All right. Okay. But we have an opportunity to impact a generation that is struggling, and I want to invite you guys to join us. KSBJ and what God is doing through KSBJ, I can read you testimony after testimony after testimony. We got an email from a young man who is traveling across country, found NGen on the app, okay? Found NGen, he was searching, he was about to commit suicide. Found NGen, heard, got a little bit of hope, decided to drive cross country to where his family is, to get himself checked into rehab and get himself right. It was the word of God that he heard over the airways through NGen that saved his life. You want to see that email? I can share it with you. You guys let me know. So I've gone way over, and I apologize. But I have one last thing that I'd like to do. but I just want to thank you so much for allowing me this time with you. I know this is valuable time. We're in the holiday season, and you guys are beautiful. Thank you for allowing me to share. This is Jesus' story just through one guy. And so what I'd like to do is ask Jim and Sue to come up. Come on. I have something for you. I know it is not easy to put these luncheons together. How often do you do this?
Once a month.
How many years have you been doing this?
About 14.
14 years. Can we give this man some love? Now, the thing that I will say is there's no Jim without Sue, and we all know that. And so that's why she is up here with him. And I want to recognize them with something that I've had the opportunity to, I make these. They're called Disciples' Crosses. You may have seen them around. I'm not the only one who makes them. But as I traveled around the world, I got to make these and give these to pastors and their wives and try and just bless them. And so the way it works is that the leather strap represents what they whipped Jesus with. The cross is made of wrapped wire that represents the crown of thorns, and the cross itself is made of nails that represent the spikes that they nailed him to the cross with. And so what I would share with all of the pastors, and I'll share with you right now, is that it's meant to remind you that you're first a disciple of Jesus Christ and to continue to be a student and pour into him, and then keep your eyes open for the opportunities to disciple others. And so I just want to recognize you guys right now. Thank you.
That's really special. Thank you. That was so amazing. Did you design this yourself?
Yeah.
It's wonderful. Thanks, thank you. Thank you very much. Sweet.
Thank you. And I just...
Can you share those statistics about the age, that if they don't know Christ before a certain age?
Yeah.
There's that statistic.
Yeah. Yeah, the kids are leaving the church at crazy rates, and the stats are in the book. And I'll just say this: I think the numbers now are like 65% or something of young people are leaving the church and won't come. And the other part of that is this study that has been done, and people can argue the studies, but if they don't hear the gospel by 18. By 18 years old, there's, I want to say, a 5 or 6% chance that they'll respond to the gospel later in life. That is scary. And for someone who lived, I don't know how I got through the first 30 years of my life without Jesus, but I don't want young people to have to go through that. I want to help equip them to be just as great as God has called them to be. And we have an opportunity to help them with that. Anything else? Is that okay? Guys, can I pray for you guys? Father in heaven, I just thank you so much for this opportunity, Lord. I don't deserve the platform that you have allowed me today in front of these wonderful people. Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would just continue to move and work, and if there is an opportunity to continue to pour into these young people, and we can impact their lives, I pray that hearts would be moved today. And Lord, we continue to lift you up and make sure that Jesus is at the center of this holiday season and that nobody takes that away. I pray for every person in this room, if they have family who are hurting or need prayer, Lord, we lift that up to you. You already know what's going on. And I pray that you keep everybody safe. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, buddy. God bless you.